Without science, there is no progress. Without technology, there is no progress. We need more scientists, we need more technologists, engineers of all kinds, technicians of all kinds. Countries that have good engineering and science are the countries that flourish. Look at the world map. Those countries who are successful are the countries that have good science and engineering, regardless of the size of the country. In the brain, human ingenuity is the most valuable natural resource of every country. And this is why every country, regardless of its condition, should develop, invest science and technology in its country. And science is not territorial. Science is international. And the language of science is English. Countries that do not have people that speak English cannot join the party of science of the world. And there are countries like that. So, you have to have the language of science, you have to have the good human capital, and you have to develop the human capital. And it should start very early. I am developing young children in the kindergartens, and I make them to think about science in open eyes. I teach science in kindergartens in Israel, my country. I have been teaching technological entrepreneurship for 30 years in my university, the Technion. Entrepreneurs are the people that take the innovation and make it into a product. Very important people. But they have to understand what they are doing. This is why education of science and technology is job one for every country. Of course, that doesn't go against the arts, doesn't go against music, painting, museum, opera, ballet, yes. These are the things that give taste to life, but life itself, these are the engineers and scientists that give life to a country.
The role of science and technology must be given priority. It has to come first because that provides the solutions. And you're not going to get a lot of work done without solutions. So we have to have the solutions to the problems, the different things that can be tried. And then I think, again, I mentioned it also in the meeting, was that at least it seems to me that the next logical step would be to touch base with society, with individuals, to bring them on board, to sort of sell the solutions to them so they can get behind it. Because at least in the US, theoretically, the citizens impact the government and the regulations. And so if you have the public on board, then they're going to impact the government. So that seems to be a logical approach to me. It may be a simplistic approach, but it seems to be a logical one.
We cannot live without new technology for future. We know we need to be in the modern life with the new technologies. Otherwise, you will be like dinosaur, getting obsolete, and the competition will kill you.
C'était une excellente question et nos gouvernements devraient se la poser beaucoup plus souvent. La science et de la technologie, de toute façon, seront les seules possibilités pour maintenir un développement durable, pour remédier aux erreurs qui ont été faites dans le passé. Il n'y a que par la science et la technologie, on ne peut pas décréter par une loi que l'environnement va être protégé si on n'a pas les moyens de le protéger. Et ça, c'est la science et la technologie qui donneront ça. Simultanément, il faut que les gens soient éduqués à la science et la technologie parce qu'on doit préparer les générations futures de ceux qui nous succéderont. Moi, j'ai 65 ans maintenant. Je peux entraîner des jeunes pour le futur. Mais c'est eux qui vont résoudre les problèmes de leur propre époque. d'ailleurs qu'on a créé et que l'époque d'avant a créé avant pour nous, avant qu'on en prenne conscience. Donc je pense qu'il y a science et technologie aussi bien au niveau, je dirais, ingénieur qu'au niveau recherche pure, parce qu'on ne sait pas d'où va venir la solution. Et l'éducation pour qu'on puisse attirer vers ces métiers-là les gens les plus capables d'inventer le futur.
Table with three pillars. Anyone is important, but saying that, I wouldn't say that all of them are the same weight on that. Indeed, the government has to understand and support that the only way to deal with the environmental topics and sustainability in general, because it's not only environmental, but it's also maintain the economic and the social welfare of the countries, they need to support, they need to understand that they cannot be balanced to only one side, whatever the side is. It's important for them to maintain a balanced position, to assure to the companies, to the, and also to the institution that dedicate effort technology, that there is a level play field for the competition from one side, but also to the institution and researchers and technology, the necessary support in policies that support strongly innovation, because this is the only way to be sure that we will be able to deal with the sustainability in the next year.
As we discussed in our symposium, we face tremendous challenges in energy, in environment, in sustainability. And these challenges are urgent challenges. They must be, you know, responded, you know, urgently, I would say. And scientists and engineers can play a very important and major role in achieving that. So science and technology are certainly the first pillar, okay, that is enabling us to respond with success to some of these challenges that we are currently now facing at the global level.
Development of our society, we face different versions of the socio-economic pathways in our developments. And we have the fossil fuel-based development up until we created the Industrial Revolution, which caused, of course, a certain value of emissions. And we do pollute and are polluting our, let's say, planet. So this doesn't seem to be very sustainable. This is exactly where science and technology comes in, which was the origin of creating the emissions that we are facing, but also is the only way to solve the challenges created by those emissions. So we don't have any other way than innovating in science and technology in order to suit the growth of our planet. We have now almost 8 billion population around the globe, and we are heading towards 9-10 billion within the next century. This means that we will be consuming further resources of the planet and creating waste products, side products. That's where exactly our scientists, our innovative businessmen will come in, entrepreneurs will come in to create the solutions so that we have a sustainable planet. that will hopefully last for an indefinite period of time. In the relation of governance and civil society, science has a very important positioning, because I hope that we will continue with our liberal way of living democracies, the freedom of the way of we are living. I hope it will sustain, and the governance will have the dominating role, because it will guide us to the way of our behavior. And there, scientists and the outcome of science innovation will have a direct impact on the decisions of our governors, our politicians. That's why science shall have, and scientists shall have, a more deeper and more progressive way of influencing the policymakers, in order to show them the way of sustainability to make our planet survive and our civilization.
It's the foundation for everything else. So really, it's in first place. Well, you can't get anywhere unless you understand the science and technology associated with all the phenomena that we are exposed to in everyday life. It's the basis for making progress in the world. And that's one reason I'm a scientist. Or really, I'm an engineer, but there's very little difference between the two. I enjoy that type of work. And thank goodness that we have people like you and me and all our colleagues at this meeting that like that and like to work in that area, because it will benefit all other aspects of society.
To me, it's the first priority, because this is where we will find the breakthroughs that change the paradigm of how we live in our environment. And I think we saw some examples during this conference, and they go back in history, but the one that struck me was the book that you showed, which was written in the 1970s, and said that we're going to run out of enough food for our world population. And here we are, how many decades later, and agricultural research has been able to increase the yield of crops per hectare sown, because of good research into hybrid plant forms, better research into fertilizers, into soil science. And we can go on into high-tech industry. I mean, the invention of the iPhone, for example, or the BlackBerry, and the invention of internet and the like, have changed the way the world communicates. So we must carry on.
I believe is the number one, because first we have to decide which is the most sustainable technology for the future, and then we can let the public know of the solutions that there are, not only the problems that we face, for example, increase in temperature, but we have so many scientific solutions like alternative energy sources and more efficient energy storage. So once we can promote this, then we can affect at a second rate public perception, and then eventually reach the politicians so they can change their policies. From the academic point of view, our goal is to try and create a sustainable future for the generations to come. So the nice thing about universities and academia is that we don't try to commercialize a product, so we can take higher risk and try to develop the pillars of the new technology that can then be commercialized. So the science that we do in the university, I think, is the main aspect that can shape our society. So just as we have the Bronze Era or the Iron Era, now we have the nanotechnology era. So we are basically formulating the future. And from the scientific point of view, we see this as the main key where we can deal with climate change and all these concerns that society has and politicians have. But unfortunately, they don't always know about these issues. They sometimes rely on sources that are not based on the scientific data. So we try to do our best to promote our basic understanding and research findings out to society and hopefully affect policy and governments.